Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through this world of toil and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely o'er to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. A closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Dear Lord, let it be. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk. Let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart And I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me.
With your love. There's a lighthouse on the inside that overlooks life's sea. And when I'm tossed around, it sings out. Everybody that leaves.
Catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I am yours, I'm
that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow.
To Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender. Savior, holy thine, let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessing fall on me.
Savior, I surrender.
surrender. To Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender. Savior, holy thine, let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. All to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all.
us to come to you, Father God. We thank you that salvation is through you alone, Jesus. And as your word says, we confess with our mouth, believe in our hearts, and we will be saved, Father God. And as you did, Father, through to fulfill all righteousness, you followed through with baptism yourself. And we thank you for that example. Lord God, I pray for these four as they're baptized today that they will fully comprehend the vastness of what this means, Lord God, and just soak it up today. May your presence be near to them, Lord God. Help them to be reminded that as your word says, you are pleased with them just to come to you. Jesus, nothing that we can do or not do can make you love us anymore. Jesus, may we all be reminded of that today, that you are pleased with us when we come to you. Jesus, we thank you so much again for the opportunity to live our lives surrendered to you. Bless this time in Jesus' name. God's people said, Father God, I just pray over them Lord God, I just pray the blood of Jesus over them. Lord God, this is the starting line of their faith. And I just pray obedience for them, and Lord, that you go before them, you go with them, Jesus. Help them again to know that you are so pleased with them and that you love them so fully, Lord God. And your love for them is not based on their performance, Jesus. Again, I pray that we all know that. Lord God, I pray that we as a church will rally around them and disciple them, be there for them. Father God, we pray your presence over the remaining part of this service. Lord God, may you just be honored and glorified throughout the whole service. We walk away from here encouraged and better equipped to live that out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. What an exciting way to begin a time of worship. We're glad that you're here. We welcome you. In your bulletin, if you received one when you came in, there's a little tear-out portion. If you are brand new with us, if this is your first time or maybe the first time in a long time, if you would please fill that out. And also, if there are prayer needs, prayer requests, things that we need to know about here, if you would let us know, we would appreciate that. Very quickly, I want to make a couple of announcements. The ministry enlistment team will be meeting this afternoon at 4 o'clock. Ministry enlistment team, 4 o'clock this afternoon. And we appreciate the work that they are doing, and we appreciate you as members and your willingness to go ahead and help with the different jobs that we have going on here at the church. Pray for our children as they go for Century Kid this week. Keep them in your prayers. Any other announcements that we need to be aware of this morning? Again, we welcome you. We thank you for coming and joining us today. If you would, let's all stand together. Ushers, if you would please come forward. We'll receive our offering this morning. Let's pray. Father, right now we come before your throne of grace, thankful for the blessings that we have received, for prayers that have been answered. And Lord, I pray that this offering that is given this morning would be used to bring glory and honor to you and to your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would be seated, and we've got some people that are going to come forward now and are going to share their experiences with us from the Impuge camp. So, folks, if y'all would come forward right now, I don't know who's going to go first. Did y'all draw straws, flip coins, or what? Who goes first? Mr. Gray, the microphone is yours. And just pass it on down the line. Thank y'all.
Well, to start off with, this year I was really blessed at Fuge. I was given the great opportunity to teach Bible study to the kids. So, naturally, I wasn't near as liked as the rest of the kids. I didn't make a little best friend, because when they came and saw me, it was time to be serious and listen. The things I taught actually tied in really, really well with our VBS that we had here, which was facing fear and trusting God. With these kids, so many of them were from such hard places to live, and they had such hard home lives, that I really wanted them to understand that no matter what they were going through, they could turn to God to not be so scared and to get through some of these things that was happening in their lives. Though at the same time, I realized that I could learn so much more by being a teacher there. My thoughts had to go so much deeper to explain something to a child and be able to make them understand it, that I think I taught myself more than anyone there. It was a really moving experience for me, well, the whole week. And I would really like to just thank y'all, the church, for all your giving and support to let us go on these trips that we take, because it really is. It makes a big difference for us.
Well, to start off, I don't have anything planned like that. I didn't write anything. Yeah, I didn't write anything down, but I had a really, I had a lot of fun at Fuge too. I was in the games and rec, and I think the kids liked me a little bit more than Andrew. And I made a lot of connections. I met two little kids that I saw every day, Caleb and Michael. They were 4 and 6. I went every day and just played games with them. I went to a camp, Camp Taylor. It's a day camp that they always go to. It's averaging, I think, 100 kids a day. And it's outside of Pritchard. But I tried to impact as many lives as I could while I was there. And I tried to have fun. I really liked the every night we would have with our church group, a devotion with just Pate and our youth group. And that got me started with a quiet time with Eric and Garrett. I don't know if Eric's here, but that got me started with that and really got me into the Word a lot more than I was, and that's how it impacted my life this year at Fuge.
Well, we all can't be as sophisticated as Andrew and have everything planned out, everything written down, but this year at Fuge, I was put in PCY, which is paint, construction, and yard work. I'm not much for paint, construction, and yard work. I like playing games and stuff, but I think God put me in PCY for a reason. I mean, I love playing with little kids, and that's just a passion of mine, but He put me there to really look at the bare minimum that people don't think about as God's plan or God's work. But when you see like yard work or just someone fixing up something or just doing anything in God's name, is just, it's a miracle to Him. And it really moved me this year. And being with Callie and Eric and Pate and having Garrett as a mentor, it's just to look up on them, and really it just brings joy into my life because I see that there's nothing wrong with being a follower of Christ and loving Him with all your heart. And I grew closer to God that week, and I just can't wait for next week or next year.
Snowy wings to my immortal home. ask y'all to do something a little strange. I'm going to ask Tracy to do his wide angle. And I want y'all to turn and look at that camera in the middle, right to the right of that screen, and say, "Hey, y'all," on 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. "Hey, y'all." Just want to make those people feel welcome out in cyberspace. We've got people potentially all over the world watching us. Doesn't that make you feel great? I'm going to let y'all stay seated. We're going to sing the next song soon and very soon. It's 3 verses, and I hope y'all enjoy singing this. It's sooner than you think, too.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Jesus is all the world to me. We want to sing the first and last verse.
Jesus is all the world to me. My life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day.
Today, I'm going to ask all of y'all to stand, and we're all going to join in this next video. There's voices on the video, so we're just going to all sing together. This is basically the gospel in a song. If you don't particularly like to sing, just speak the word. It doesn't matter if we're in tune. It's the message, it's the lyrics, it's the words that count. This is important words, and actually the gospel in words, and can't be wrong by singing this. And just speak the words if you don't care to sing. Okay?
Thank you.
Has been presented. And there's never been a problem in our churches with the gospel being presented. The problem is the gospel being paid attention to. That's where we are. In the book of Romans chapter 6, if you will turn with me there this morning, Romans chapter 6, we're going to be looking at verse 4. First, I'd like to tell you about a church member church member's name was Mark, and Mark was the typical church member. He had attended church since he was a boy. Everybody knew him. He had grown up in the church, and everybody knew Mark, but nobody really knew him. You know, you really can never get on the inside of somebody else's head, so you're always just kind of wondering, where is this person? What is this individual about? Nobody was able to really crack that shell, if you will. Now Mark had a problem. He was a good husband. He was a good provider, but he just had a problem. He'd never really gotten close to his wife. There was something always there, and the relationship with his children was somewhat strained. And then there was, he was inside the church, obviously, but for people outside of the church, he had very little tolerance for them. And then people on the inside of the church, he tended to judge quite harshly. There was a problem. Deacon asked him one time, said, "Mark, are you happy?" And he said, "Well, yes." And he said, "Well, you need to tell your face." You know, there was a disconnect there. The problem with Mark was that he was not changing. He was not being transformed in any meaningful way. He was just the same. He was doing exactly what was expected, and there was no transformation day by day. And what's heartbreaking about this is that nobody in the church was surprised. Nobody really expected change. Nobody really expected a transformation. Nobody expected that he might grow in love and that he might grow in the grace and the mercy of the Lord and that he might become more Christ-like every day in his life. They weren't surprised. Now, there were other expectations within the church. Nobody be misled. People in the church, whether he was being transformed or not, they expected him to attend church regularly. Everybody? They expected that he would read his Bible. They expected that he would adhere to the right beliefs. They expected that he would tithe. But they did not expect that his life would be really changed. I want to tell y'all something this morning. There are a lot of Marks running around the world today. They've got the, well, they know the right words to say. They've got the right belief set, if you will, but there's been no transforming process. Nothing different day by day. It all stays the same. We're going to talk this morning for just a little bit about what is true spirituality, and I'd like to begin in the book of Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Let's pray. Father, this morning I'm just so thankful for everything that has occurred, for the baptisms, Lord, for the music, for the worship. We come before your throne of grace with praise and with thanksgiving, asking, Father, that by the power of your Spirit, you would overshadow this place and speak to each of our hearts. Let it be done for your glory, in Jesus' name. True spirituality. What is true spirituality? If it's not regular church attendance, if it's not reading your Bible and adhering to the right set of core beliefs, if it's not tithing, if it's not all of these things that we've come to expect, what is true spirituality? How do we define it? More importantly, how do we maintain it? Where does it come from? How can we share in that? And how can it indeed transform our lives? I want you to think of some ironies this morning for a moment, if you will, because spirituality sometimes is wrongly understood. Imagine this, spiritual life that leads to lifelessness. Something wrong there. Spiritual growth that produces misery. That doesn't fit the picture either. Life that is supposedly yielded to God, rebelling against God. But these are the things that we have come to expect as normal. People, and I've run into folks all through the years talking about they joined the church when they were children. And, you know, preacher, I got up and I got out and I got away from God and I got out of the church and things just kind of went downhill for me from there. And, you know, preacher, everybody's got to have their wilderness experience. Y'all know. Just a point of order here. There was a generation of Israelites that died in the wilderness. We need to get it right. We need to keep it right. We need to understand what true spirituality is. When people are not authentically transformed by the power of God, they begin to do things to compensate for that. They often settle for what we might even consider a pseudo-spirituality, a false spirituality, and that would be the person who is in church every week, the person that's in church every time the doors open. Because that's what's expected. Yes, preacher, I read my Bible, and yes, preacher, I tithe, and I do all the right things. We know that we are supposed to, as children of the living God, we know we're supposed to be different from the world. Everybody? Just, you know, we know that. We are supposed to be different. The world ought to look at us and they ought to have a hunger to have what we have. There ought to be something in our life that would cause them to thirst after what God has done for us. If there's nothing going on in your life, if you can so blend in with the crowd and nobody notices anything, something is lacking. There's been no transformation. There's been no move toward getting closer to God. If the heart is not changing and getting closer to God, then we look for ways, perhaps superficial, visible ways, if you will, that we might prove to the world that we're actually very spiritual. And y'all do know what happens when some people get a good dose of it. It's that little bit of, I'm a little more spiritual than you are. In Chilton County, we would have called that holier than thou. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some people get that, and it's not really from a true spirituality. It's just I'm doing all the right things better than you are. No transformation, but I'm doing all the right things better than you are. I'm better at this Christian thing than you are. We may think that spiritual maturity is simply about how much Bible we know. It's not. Over the years, I have known people that were just truly and really drunk. And they could quote the Bible better than I could while they were truly drunk. Bible knowledge alone does not get it. Somebody once said that if reading the Bible is all that you've done, that will perhaps make you doctrinal. If praying is all that you do, then perhaps that might make you fanatical. There is a blend that we need to get. It is the Bible. It is prayer, but it's living our lives every day in Christ's likeness. If we rigidly immerse ourselves in a host of different spiritual practices, we might feel good about what we're doing, but if we're not being transformed by the power of God, something is lacking. Don't you desire this morning to know more of Christ? To know more of the fullness of His power in your life? Don't you desire to walk in that place of genuine spiritual maturity where the world can do what it will, but your faith will not be shaken? Your life will not be deterred from living it for Him. We're human beings, and sometimes we tend to look down on those who are not working on their spirituality as hard as we are. Y'all know what I'm talking about? We look down on those who are not doing all the right things. We might tend to look down on the church member who's missed 2 or 3 months. Now, it would never occur to us to call and find out if something was wrong. Everybody, y'all come on. You know exactly what I'm talking about. We tend to look down on others, and when we do that, we're the ones who become judgmental. We're the ones who are judging them based on our competitiveness, if you will, because we're really working after this thing. We're really doing it hard. We've done all the right things. If we focus solely on outward behaviors while ignoring the deeper things of the heart, we've missed the boat. If all we're looking at is the practice and not the motivation, we're missing something there. We need to hear the words of Jesus over and over again as He spoke to those who were the religious leaders of His day to kind of get them straight on what was happening and their being so judgmental in their lives. That judgment thing, that's a deadly disease. And it's extremely contagious. We can pass that on from one to the other. A right understanding of our spiritual life is really what is needed. And if I were to ask you this morning, any one of you, if I stopped you in the hall or in the foyer and I said to you, how is your spiritual life going? Think about that for a moment. What would your answer be? Some would say, well, preacher, I'm in church. That much is pretty obvious. If I ask you while you were in church, how is your spiritual life going? How would you go about defining spiritual progress in your life? How would you go about knowing indeed that something was going on? There was a transformation that was taking place. There was a change in the heart that had begun to take over. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, he that saith he abideth in Him ought himself also so to walk, even as He walked. To pursue a growth in your spiritual life, simply put, it means to know more of Jesus Christ every day, to imitate Him, if you will, in how He walked and how He communicated with other people. There is a common denominator in those who are seeking to have a deeper spiritual life. In the book of Mark, chapter 12, verse 30 and 31, Jesus said, "And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment, and the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these." To love God with every ounce, every fiber of your being, and to love others as you love yourself. That's the capsule. That's the truth. That is a sign of a spiritually growing life. The real question, if I were to ask, how's your spiritual life going? The real question might be simply this: are you loving God more? Are you loving others more? Not how often you've been in church, not how much of the Bible have you memorized, not how many thousands of dollars you might have contributed over the years. Are you loving God more? Are you loving others more? See, you are the one to judge that. I'd share with you this one thought this morning. We talk a lot about discipleship. And I was so thankful for our young people sharing this morning. And by the way, if you will come back this evening for our evening service, even more of them will be sharing tonight their experiences. And I think it would be good for you to hear those. And I think it would be good for them if this place was packed out completely so they'd understand what nervousness really looked like. But we talk about discipleship. We talk about doing more for Him. And I would ask you to think with me for a moment, if everybody in this church put into practice this one simple concept, doing life in Jesus' name, what would that look like? What would it look like if every one of us in here today began to do life in Jesus' name? In the book of Colossians chapter 3, verse 17, there is a passage of Scripture that I'd like to read to you. "And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him." Your spiritual life, is God concerned about that? Oh, absolutely. But He's not just concerned about your spiritual life. He's concerned about your whole life. He's concerned about every aspect of your life today, tomorrow, and into the future. Every moment of your life gives you an opportunity to live your life in Jesus' name. Now, I will tell you this, if everybody in the church were to do life in Jesus' name, was to put this into practice, then we would have the perfect church. And then you would have to call somebody else to be your pastor, because I'm not perfect. God's not just in this sanctuary. God is in your life as you live it every day, through the power of His Holy Spirit. You know, I didn't understand that when I got saved. Not having any church background, I didn't know what that was like. I didn't know what all of that meant. As I grew, I became aware of God being present in my life. There was something guiding me that had not been there before. Our lives in Christ are different. They're supposed to be different. I'm going to say this, and I don't want anybody to misunderstand, because this is the truth. The God that we serve is not obsessed about your religion. He's obsessed and concerned about your life. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. God is concerned this morning about your life. We need to consciously, as individuals, as a church, as families, we need to consciously turn toward Him and allow God to lead us through the power of His Spirit. All of our everyday lives. And you know what? Sometimes life is not altogether pleasant. Sometimes life can throw us some curves. Sometimes anybody ever thought when the clock went off in the morning, I'm just going to turn that off and cover my head up? I just don't want to face another day like yesterday was, or like last week was, or like the last year or two have been. Everyday life can be lived in victory, filled with His presence. I'm not going to stand here and tell you that every day is going to be absolutely pleasant and it's all going to be rosy and you'll never have another problem. You'll never have another flat tire, and none of the appliances in your house will ever go out. Not going to tell you that. I'm not going to tell you that your roof won't ever leak. I'm not going to tell you that your children will always do exactly what you think they ought to. I'm not going to tell you that you and your spouse will always agree. But I am going to tell you that if we are willing to put this life on His altar, the Holy Spirit will absolutely alter us and how we look at our lives. Doing life in Jesus' name. Living life according to the Word of God. Looking for and expecting God to bless and use us in His kingdom's work and service. Not judging by what we do, but judging what we are inside. I want to ask you, are you closer to God today than you were last month, last year? Are you closer to God today than you were the day that you got saved? Are you closer to God now than you were when your children were born? See, that was the problem with Mark. Life happened, but his life wasn't being transformed through Christ. What about you today? You know God's got a plan and a purpose for you. Had the conversation this morning. People in the South, look, we are so exposed to churches. There's not a one of you in here today that does not know the right thing to do, the godly thing to do. We can't plead ignorance. We've heard the gospel presentation. We know what it means to come to God, to submit to God. See, that's our problem. There's a difference between knowing it and doing it. I challenge you this morning. God's speaking to your heart. do it. Let's pray. Father, right now, we're so convinced of your love and mercy. We're so convinced of your grace. So convinced of the sacrifice of Jesus. Right now, in the quietness of this moment of invitation, it is my prayer that each one of us